Today, I wanted to do something a little different to my normal videos, where I spend an egregious amount of time showing you how to do a few fairly simple processes. I recently finished a master's degree in microbiology, although I haven't technically graduated yet, so what better way to celebrate than by making a video on microbiology? More specifically, my favourite teeny tiny little part of it. This thing right here. The one the arrow is pointing at. That's a bacterium. Escherichia coli, to be exact. But if we zoom way in, you can see I've added a tiny little bit on the side here using my impeccable Photoshop skills. This little bit is one of the coolest parts of all of microbiology, in my opinion. It is a bacteriophage, commonly shortened to phage. The name stems from a combination of bacteria, meaning bacteria, and the Greek word phagein, meaning devourer. Or at least that's what it should mean when pronounced correctly. Put those together, and you've got bacteria eater. Which is kind of what bacteriophages do. Not in the literal sense. They don't physically consume and digest bacteria. But if you want to be dramatic, it wouldn't be the biggest push in the world to say they consume the very heart and soul of bacteria. Bacteriophages drain their essence. But from the moment the essence of a bacteria fuels them, they live a half-life. A cursed life. Because, technically, being viruses, phages are not even alive in the first place. They don't respire, they don't metabolize, they don't grow, there's no waste products, and they can only reproduce by using the molecular machinery of their unfortunate hosts. To very quickly sum up the phage reproductive cycle, I've made a short, terrible animation. Here is a phage showing the head containing the phage genome, the tail, which is a long, hollow tube, effectively, the base plate, which breaches the bacterial cell wall, and the tail fibers, which attach to the bacterium in the first place. The phage latches onto a bacterium and injects its genome. The bacterial ribosome then uses this genome to produce phage protein and thus more phage. It's actually a lot more complicated than that, but the simplified version is that the bacterial ribosome produces more phage. This continues until there are too many phages inside the bacteria, and the bacterial cell usually bursts. This is called lysis. It often results in the death of bacteria. Which is terrible for the bacteria, obviously, but not so terrible for us. Unless you happen to be a lab scientist trying to study bacteria, in which case, yes, it's terrible for us too, as they have a tendency to ruin plate cultures. But for everyone else, less so. Because they can be used in a little thing called phage therapy. Some of you might have heard of it, because it's slowly gaining popularity in the West. In the areas of the Soviet Union, well, it's a bit more popular. One of the first people to discover bacteriophages, and there's been a few, just to add to your confusion, was an ardent communist and managed to help it become rather popular, to the point that in some places they are used almost as much as antibiotics. But that comes later. We can get into the who, how, why, where, and what of phage therapy later on. First, let's go back to their early history. Allow me to give you a brief insight into the fascinating history of phage therapy. The year is 1896. A well-respected English researcher is studying the properties of river water from the Ganga and Yamuna rivers, and he goes by the name of Ernest Hanbury Hankin, and let me tell you, there's few men with a more English-sounding name. He happens to notice that fewer people are getting sick when they drink the water from these rivers. Normally, you can expect a certain number of people to contract cholera when they imbibe of dirty water, especially in the days prior to effective sewage treatment. But here, that didn't seem to be happening, and our good chap Mr. Hanbury Hankin was curious, so he decided to investigate. He found that there was something in the water that inhibited bacterial growth, or killed them off. This substance could still be seen when the water was passed through a fine porcelain sieve, which would normally filter out things like bacteria or other larger organisms, but was no longer effective when the water was boiled. This tells us two things. First, the cause of this dramatic effect is very, very tiny, and therefore not another bacteria, or something that ingests them. Secondly, this thing is killed by heat, and as a result is either alive or somehow removed, or killed, by heating, with full air quotes on the word killed. Hankin assumed that the effect was due to a volatile component of the water, which is to say one that evaporates quickly and is no longer present after the boiling. Volatile components are difficult to use in day-to-day life, which is one of the reasons you've probably never had real wasabi. Our boy Ernest publishes his findings via the Pasteur Institute under the title L'action des eaux de la Yumna et de la Ganga sur les vibrions du cholera. Roughly translated, that's the bactericidal action of the water from the Yamuna and Ganges on the cholera vibrion, where bactericidal means bacteria killing, and vibrion is an old name for a microbe. In summary, this water kills cholera. Hankin did not continue his work, but fortunately for us, the story doesn't end there. In 1915, another English researcher by the name of Frederick Twort started doing some work on phages himself. He came to the conclusion that their effect was due to the result of one of three possibilities. 1. The effect was part of the life cycle of the bacteria. 2. The effect was due to an enzyme produced by the bacteria. Or 3. It was a separate life form that grew on and destroyed the bacteria. Twort himself was of the opinion that the effect was down to the second possibility, an enzyme the bacteria produced to attack other organisms. This would make sense, as it would reduce competition for resources, although now of course we know that's not the case. Unfortunately, the outbreak of the First World War interrupted his research, and after the war he chose not to continue. His work was published in The Lancet, a well-reputed scientific journal, but wasn't picked up on beyond cursory interest. His role as a discoverer of bacteriophages would have been forgotten, if not for the rediscovery of his paper some years later. However, he was not alone in his research. Another researcher enters our story in the year 1917, this time a Frenchman by the name of Félix Tourelle. He independently works on phages and finds, like Twort and Hankin before him, these invisible antagonistic microbes, in the case of the dysentery bacteria, are able to pass through a fine porcelain filter and retain their disruptive capabilities. Unlike Twort, Durrell believes these microbes to be a separate organism, something not proven until some 20 years later, when electron microscope images of bacteriophages are published. He is able to isolate phages from chicken feces, and later goes on to use them to treat dysentery, first in chickens and then in a man. It is the first ever application of phage therapy. But there's one more thing you need to know about Monsieur Durrell. He is an ardent communist. His work is noticed by a certain George Eliava. If you've read anything about phage therapy, that name should be familiar to you, but we'll get onto that later. He invites Durrell to join him in the Soviet Union, in the area now within the country of Georgia, not to be confused with the US state of Georgia. Here they begin the formation of what became the Eliava Institute. This is a place dedicated to the research and application of phage therapy, to treat infections and improve the quality of life for people everywhere. Their work reduces the burden of scarlet fever on the soldiers of the Soviet Union to an incredible degree. But this tale of camaraderie does not have a happy ending, and if you'll forgive the overdramatic relish with which I do so, allow me to tell you a tale. Here enters the villain of our story, and of many other stories, I'm afraid. His name is Lavrenty Pavlovich Beria, played so well in the recent excellent film The Death of Stalin by Simon Russell Beale. This man is cruel, callous, and brutal. He can be described as a monster or worse, and as a known paedophile, rapist, and murderer. He is also one of the highest-ranking members of the Communist Party ruling over the Soviet Union, and even Stalin is afraid to leave his own daughter alone with the man, and he's interested in the woman that George Eliava loves. A rivalry between them blooms as a result, but while Beria has power, Eliava does not, and in the Soviet Union this could only ever have gone one way. In 1937, George Eliava is executed as traitor and denounced as an enemy of the people, while Durrell, who either fled to Paris shortly after Eliava's execution or was there at the time it occurred, never returns to the Soviet Union and his book is banned from circulation. Durrell dies without recognition in 1949. However, phage therapy did take off well in the Soviet Union and helped keep the troops somewhat safe from infection, with phage therapy remaining reasonably common until the regime's deconstruction. Durrell is recognised as worthy of being a Nobel laureate decades after his death, although sadly the award is usually not awarded posthumously. In the West, meanwhile, the meteoric rise of penicillin and other antibiotics far outcompetes the use of phage therapy, due in part to a lack of understanding on the part of scientists in how to store and use phages correctly. Their continued reliance on antibiotics leads to a small problem, but one you may have heard about.
Superbugs.
Highly antibiotic-resistant bacteria able to survive the toxic chemicals that some organisms spent millions of years evolving and developing specifically to kill them. The overprescription and poor use of antibiotics has led to an era of such resilient bacteria that one of our biggest worries right now is totally resistant gonorrhea, which we simply can't cure or treat with any certainty whatsoever. And if that's not a kick in the balls, I don't know what is. But hope is on the horizon. Phage therapy is still alive and kicking in the country of Georgia, in the former Soviet Union, where they use phages to treat resistant infections with reasonable regularity, and where they also perform significant research into their use. The main centre for this research? is the George Eliava Institute. Told you that name would be familiar. Research continues there to this day and is also being done at multiple universities around the globe, including the Clokey Lab at Leicester. The head of the Clokey Lab, Professor Martha Clokey, was in the excellent and highly educational podcast Infinite Monkey Cage with Professor Brian Cox, which I highly recommend listening to. In short, the subject of phages and phage therapy is one with a detailed and storied history, and one that is continually added to this day. I highly recommend you look further into the subject, and this was absolutely not me begging for a job. I've included some links down below to various Wikipedia pages, videos, and institutes still working on phages. Thank you for watching, and stay healthy.